Welcome to this short lecture just on QI factorization, how to decompose a matrix A where each of the columns are mutually or at least linearly independent, and we're going to change that basis into these two new matrices Q and R. Q is going to be very nice because all those column vectors in it, they're going to be orthonormal, so they're all orthogonal to each other and they are of unit length, and then R is going to be an upper triangular matrix. So I'm Dr. Jean Klopper. Amongst other things, I'm a research fellow at the School for Data Science and Computational Thinking at Stellenbosch University. And as you can see here, I'm using a Pluto notebook, so we can use Julia, the Julia language, an exceptionally perfect language when it comes to computational thinking. And I urge you to, if you're not already familiar, to learn more about Julia. I've got a bunch of videos right here on YouTube. And then even a university level course that you can get a certificate on as far as a massive open online course is concerned on the Coursera platform. So you can learn all about Julia. So what I'm going to just assume that you have a bit of knowledge about vector arithmetic, about the projection of a vector onto another vector. That's going to be very important. About linear independence, because we want all our column vectors initially at least to be linearly independent so that they form a basis for a subspace at least of a vector space. With respect to our matrix A, the rank of a matrix, because that also just helps us to understand or make sure that our column vectors are mutually or at least linearly independent, what orthogonality is, and then the normalization of a matrix, and what I mean by that, that each of those column vectors, that you can normalize those column vectors. So the Julia packages that we're going to use in this notebook are linear algebra and row echelon. So if you're setting up your environment, and remember I do have a video to show you how to set up an environment for each and one of your projects, never ever just use the base installation of Julia and do everything in that. Rather create individual environments for each of your projects and then install only the packages that you need into that environment specific to that project. So for this project, I'm just showcasing a bit of linear algebra using Julia. I'm using the row echelon package that I had to install, and then linear algebra, that package as part of Julia. So here's our matrix. It is three column vectors, and we have three of them. So in actual fact, they are mutually orthogonal, linearly independent, and that means it spans all of three space. But very often you're going to have more rows than columns, so you're only going to span a subspace. So let's just set up A, and it's very easy in the Julia language. We're going to enter the values row by row, leaving little spaces between the elements, and then every new row is denoted by a semicolon. And I'm going to assign that to the computer variable A, and you can see with the Pluto notebooks, the execution of the code is just above the line of the code. And just to show that those three column vectors are linearly independent, what we can do, of course, is set up the homogeneous system. And if they are linearly independent, the only solution to the linear system is going to be the zero vector. Or you can just look at the matrix itself and just, because this is square in this instance, do use elementary row operations, reduce it to reduced row echelon form through Gauss-Jordan elimination. And if it ends up being the identity matrix, of course, those three column vectors are linearly independent. And you can see there, I'm using the row echelon package. So I always use that if this is the first time I use a function, just to remind me from what package that function comes. So the RREF, row reduced echelon form function, pass A as my parameter or argument to it, and I get the identity matrix. I can also just use the dot rank method, or that would be the rank function, I should say, in the linear algebra package, pass A as parameter or argument, and we can see it's got a rank of 3. In other words, those columns are linearly independent. So in the linear algebra package, there's also a QR function, and you can see QR there, pass A to it. It's going to return two matrices, so we're assigning it to two computer variables, Q and R. And once we do that, we see both Q and R. And remember, you're going to find these little overflow errors there. So anything times 10 to the power negative 16, in computer speak, that means a zero. So we see these three, they are, each three of these column vectors are of unit length, and they are all orthogonal to each other. So this is an orthonormal basis for three space as far as our matrix A is concerned. And you see R there as well, and you can see it's upper triangular with the zeros below the main diagonal. just to show you, if we multiply Q and R, we get back our original matrix with a proviso that these things times 10 to the power 16 are really zero. So we just get back to where we are. So if we have a bunch of basis vectors, and that each column in A, that is a basis for either the space or a subspace, we've got to choose one of them to start off with. And here we're just going to keep things easy. We're just going to start with the first one. Now, what I'm going to do, the notation that I'm going to use, is that each column vector in A is just going to be A sub 1, A sub 2, and A sub 3. And then the new basis is going to be U sub 1, U sub 2, U sub 3, such as, remember that U sub 1, U sub 2, U sub 3 are each orthogonal, they're mutually orthogonal. And when I make them unit length, I put a little hat on them, such that we have equation 2 here. So I'm just going to choose the first one, A1, to be U1, because all the others will now subsequently have to be orthogonal to them, but I've got one. Don't just grab one out of the air from the subspace that you're dealing with. Take one of the ones that you have. So for me, column vector 1, that's A1, and that's going to be U1. And if I divide that by the norm of A1, then I have a unit vector, and I'll call that U hat sub 1. So I'm just going to extract the first column vector there, just using index notation. So you can see there A, and then square brackets, colon means all the rows, comma, first column. So that's just going to be the 111. And that's what we see there, 111. And if we click and Pluto on that little downward arrow there, we see it's a column vector 111. That's what we have. And I'm just going to set U1 to be A1. So I'm just saying assigning A1, that first column vector, to U1. And then just to get the magnitude of that vector, I'm just using the norm function, passing A1 to that, and we see the numerical approximation for the norm of that vector. And then so that I have U1 norm, remember that's the one with a little hat on, as U1 divided by norm of U1. And there we have it. We have our first vector in our new basis, our orthonormal basis, and it is of unit length. Now I'm going to go to just a little Google drawing, because I just want to remind you of what the projection of a vector onto another vector is and how that helps us beautifully in this Gram Schmidt process. Let's have a look. So there we go, there's my little drawing. And I have my vector A1 here, the orange one at the bottom, and A sub 2 there. Now they're not the same as the problem that we're dealing with. It's just a little schematic just to remind you what this idea is of a projection. So I want to do the projection of A2 onto A1. Now remember, A1 we've chosen as U1. So what we're looking for is another vector in the space that is orthogonal to this vector. And if you think about a projection of a vector onto another vector, so you see this component now, is this pink one, is along A1. That's the component of A2 along A1. And because it's orthogonal, we have this very beautiful pink one going up to the left here, and that's U sub 2. By the way, that we set up these projections, they are these two one, these the projection and how you get the projection, they are orthogonal to each other. So we might as well make that U2. And remember, what we'll do is, if this pink one at the bottom, if that's the projection, plus U2 just gives me back A2. So you see at the top A2, A sub 2, that's the projection of A sub 2 onto U sub 1, plus U sub 2. Now putting in U there, just to remind you, it's actually A1, but A1 is U1, so it doesn't matter. So if you add the projection and you add U2, you get back to A2. Now you know what A2 is, so we can just solve for U sub 2. It's just A2 minus the projection. And then you have U2, and if you make that into a position vector, so take it to the left, you now have the orange vectors as U sub 1, or A sub 1 is now U sub 1, and you have U sub 2. And they're orthogonal to each other, and all you need to do is normalize them, and then they're orthonormal. As simple as that. And if you have A sub 3, now they've all got to be orthogonal to each other. So with A sub 3 and its projection, you better get the projection onto A sub 2 and onto A sub 1. Because what you really want is you want it to be orthogonal to everything. Let's get back to the code and I'll show you. So yeah, I'm reminding you how we do these projections. So the projection of A sub 2 onto A sub 1, or U sub 1 now. Remember, that is the dot product of the two divided by the norm of the one that you're projecting onto, times the one you're projecting onto. Remember, that's how we do the projections, if you can't remember. So here we have A sub 2. I've just extracted A sub 2, 0, 1, 1, that column vector. And I'm calculating now projection of U sub 1, of A sub 2 onto U sub 1. And I'm giving it an appropriate computer variable name. And this is how you do the dot product. You use the dot function, and then this the just as arguments separated by a comma, my two vectors. So a sub 2 and u sub 1. And what I'm doing is then dividing it by the norm of u sub 1 squared, as we have in 3 up here, and then multiplied by u sub 1. All I'm doing. And then there we go. I get that projection. But that's not what we're interested in. We want to use it, such as to remember that u sub 2 plus that projection equals a sub 2, and I can solve for u sub 2, and that's exactly what we do here. We say u sub 2 equals a sub 2 minus the projection we've just done, and that gives us u sub 2, and there we have u sub 2. And all I have to do now is to divide it by its norm, and now I have a unit, another unit vector. And 5 is what it's all about. I just want to show you that. Remember, it's got to be mutually orthogonal to everything that came before it. So if I take any a sub n, because next time, remember, we're going for a sub 3, I go to u sub 3. Remember, that's the orthogonal part. And I add to that all of these things here. That's the u sub n is the one that I want. And I add this, I'm doing this summation, and all the ones that go before that. So I'm cycling from I equals 1 to n minus 1. So all the ones that came before. So 3 will be, it's got to be against a sub 1 and a sub 2. Not a sub 3, I'm working with a sub 3. So it just goes to n minus 1. So it's the dot product of a sub n dotted with u sub I. So it'll be u sub 1 first, then u sub 2, divided by that norm squared, multiplied by itself. And all I have to do is just, as before, we solve for u sub n. So u sub n is going to be a sub n minus the summation, just going from I equals 1 to I equals 2, just to stop at n minus 1. So if we look at the projection of a sub 3 onto a u sub 2, we also have to look at the projection of a sub 3 onto u sub 1, just as we have here in the summation for 5. And so let's do that. Let's just extract the third column vector there, 0, 0, 1. And I'm doing the projection there of a 3 onto u 2 and onto u 1. We need both of them. And then here's our little expansion. So it's u sub 3 plus the projection of a sub 3 onto u sub 1 and the projection of a sub 3 onto u sub 2. And that equals, as you can see there, and all we're doing is we're going to solve for u sub 3. And once we solve for u sub 3, this is what we do. U sub 3 is a sub 3 minus this projection minus that projection. And once we do that, we just divide it by its norm. And we have our third column vector. And all I'm doing now is just putting them all together as u hat. But remember, that's just q. That's just q. And what I'm showing you here, if I take the dot product between each of them, bar this to the power negative 16, negative 17, remember those all zeros. If I take the dot product between each of them now, I end up with zero. So they are indeed orthogonal to each other. And if I normalize each of them, they are orthonormal. As simple as that. Now, with QR factorization, I just want to show you then just the form that R takes. It's upper triangular, and it's just these dot products with each other. And if you do that, you get R calculated. Now, you'll see there is going to be a difference, because what we've used here is a simplified method. Let's put it that way. Because this is not going to necessarily deal, this is over field of reals, but we've got to think of a field of complex numbers, for instance. So there's actually, I just want to warn you a bit more to this, but when we're dealing with the reals, this is absolutely just an easy bunch of steps to follow. What I do want to remind you then is just the fact that we're just using the dot product here because it was just over the reals and we're just in Euclidean space. But when we move away to things that are a bit more interesting, we use the inner product. Remember, the dot product is then the special case in that instance of the inner product. So I just want to remind you, in actual fact, it's not the dot product, but it's the inner product. And then 9 is exactly the same as equation 5 as before. It's just that we have to deal with the inner product. So if you can define an inner product space, you can do QR decomposition, and that's really powerful. And then I also just show you the real form of what R would look like. Not a bunch of dot products, but a bunch of inner products. And now, you know, you can really expand it as far as what you view as vectors, and you needn't stick to just vectors in Euclidean space, as long as you can define that inner product and the space that you're dealing with meets the assumptions for for an inner product space, then you're good to go. So that was the Gram Schmidt process, just showing you how easy it is to use Julia code. As I said, look in the link in the description down below. When I have time, I'll put in all those links in the description and you can learn a lot more about Julia. Otherwise, go to my YouTube channel, JH Klopper, and you'll find lots of video tutorials on the use of Julia.